Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into this world. We take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
We are gathered today to celebrate the life of Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne. Let us now receive his body for burial. With faith in Jesus Christ, we receive the body of our brother, Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne, for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Thelston, We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gates of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Remain standing as we sing the opening hymn, How Great Thou Art.
I am sure, please sir, I am sure that with this crowd, we can make a lot more noise as we give God thanks for the life of your good friend and brother. And so, please, let's add a little gusto to our singing. Even though it's hurting us, we are saying, Lord, we thank you today for him. So please, second verse, and I need to hear you.
Thank you.
As we pay tribute to Thelston Payne, we're now going to start the tributes, and we invite Mr. Milton Small of the Cricket Legends of Barbados to begin the tributes. And this will be followed by a video presentation from the St. Catherine's Sports and Social Club. Mr. Small.
Let me say good morning to each and everyone gathered here to celebrate the life of Thelston. It is hard for me to pay this tribute because of the friendship that me and Thelston had over the years. But be that as it may be, let me proceed. Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne, known to most people as Carew, or Trop, and affectionately to some as Papi, was your father, family man, cricketer, coach, and friend. As your father, Payne was devoted to his two sons, Damien and Dwayne. He loved them very much and would do anything within reason and his means to make them happy. He was very fond of his siblings as well. Whenever he spoke about them, his love and respect for them was evident in his actions and voice. I first met Thelston in the latter part of the 70s, when as a young lad, I would journey to St. Catherine's Club to watch cricket and operate the scoreboard. It was from that time our friendship started, and it grew even stronger when I started to play cricket for St. Catherine's as well. It was a genuine camaraderie that lasted until his passing. Payne's educational journey started at the St. Martin's Mangrove Primary School and Princess Margaret Secondary, where his cricketing skills and talent was nurtured, something which was earlier observed by the residents in Fowl Bay, the area in which he grew up. As a small lad running around the neighborhood in short pants, whenever he batted, the older boys would have trouble getting him out, hence the name Carew was casted upon him after the prolific West Indies opening batsman Joey Carew. Payne scored loads of runs for Princess Margaret in the BCA second division competition, and it is rumored by one of his schoolmates that he was the only batsman that in the nets that hooked the fast and fearsome Wayne Daniel in the nets at school practice. After leaving secondary school, Payne joined the St. Catherine's Cricket Club, a team he represented for his entire cricketing career. St. Catherine's became a home away from home for him. Those days, if you passed by the club, I guarantee that his car would be parked in front of the building. Just like at Princess Margaret, Thelston scored runs for St. Catherine's regularly. On a Saturday, he and his opening partner, the late Ian Chatterton, would have most of the bowlers of the opposing teams looking for cover from the licks coming from the blaze of their bats. And it is because of these continuous performances, Payne was called up to trials for the Barbados national team. He performed exceptionally well in those trials and was selected in 1999, where he made his debut against Jamaica. And that was the beginning of your fruitful career representing his country. I can recall going to Kensington Oval to watch Payne playing a match for Barbados versus the Combined Islands, as the team was called back in those days, to witness one of the best centuries that I have ever seen. And I have seen many of them. He scored 140 scintillating runs. Thelston got stuck into the then West Indies pacer Andy Roberts and the rest of the bowling contingent. Payne was fearless on that day. Every time Andy pitched short, the ball was retrieved from inside or over the Kensington stand. It was because of these impressive performances around that time that Thelston was selected and carried on the West Indies A-team trip to Zimbabwe. There he also put in some credible performances. 1984, for Payne, was the moment all West Indian cricketers lived for. Payne was selected to be on the West Indies team to tour England. This came about after some outstanding performances for Barbados, which helped them win the Shell Shield Cup, as the regional competition was then named. In 1986, finally, what Thelston had worked hard towards all those previous years happened. He received his cap and made his test debut against England in Port of Spain, Trinidad. He held 5 catches in that match and scored 5 runs. 1984 also afforded Thelston with lots of joy and experiences. After being on tour with the West Indies and working in the hotel industry for a few years prior, the then chairman of the National Sports Council, Sir David Simmons, who admired Thelston's batting abilities, offered him a job at the council, which he readily accepted. Before taking up disappointment at the council, Payne had to make his way to the coaching center at Little Shaw to pursue his coaching certificate, which he attained successfully. On returning home, Thelston was handed a program to go into the primary and secondary schools to develop cricket, and he did just that for over 30 years. During that time, Payne also coached a number of development squads at the Sports Council and even accompanied them on tours to Trinidad, St. Kitts, and England. Being a coach, I can tell you it did not slow down Payne in any form or fashion. He still continued to play cricket locally for St. Catharines, and it is during one of these matches that I remember the game St. Catharines versus Spartan, which was always a big match for the two clubs. Thelston the batsman and George Linton the bowler. 12 runs was taken off the over, and not a boundary was struck. Thelston and his partner, the late Terry Watson, ran 6 twos to the amazement of George and the spectators watching. Another incident, quite comic. Thelston and Carew Bass, batting for Barbados in a game at Kensington Oval versus Guyana. And they were batting out of character because, you know, these two gentlemen like to play a lot of shots, pushing the ball all around. And during one of their mid-pitch conference, they were joined in the middle of the pitch by a gentleman who had climbed over the fence of the Kensington stand and went to meet them at mid-pitch. When he got there at mid-pitch, the question was asked, what plan do you guys have in mind? After it was explained to him what plan they had in mind, he turned and hurriedly made his way back to the stands to report to the rest of the spectators. In 2006, Thelston was one of the gentlemen who formed a company called the Cricket Legends of Barbados, which comprised of all past Barbadian cricketers who represented the West Indies. And there was no activity put on by this company that Thelston did not participate in. Whether it was sitting at the Oval talking cricket with Sir Wes Hall and many others of the Cricket Legend, or enjoying a night out at the Legends headquarters, the most recent being on the 31st of March, 2023. Thelston loved life. He also loved people. And the people loved that Payne in return. Be it his former workmates, the children at the schools he worked with, or his cricketing colleagues. To them, Payne was the consummate gentleman. One of the things which touched Payne's heart and brought tears to his eyes was on the 9th of February, 2005, when his alma mater named the pavilion at school in his honor. Incidentally, there's also a balcony at St. Catharines Cricket Club, which carries his name. During one of our chats, which we usually had, Payne said to me, "Big man," and that is what Payne would always refer to me as. It is always nice to have these things done when you're alive, so that you can be, so that you know you are appreciated. Thelston also enjoy other pastimes outside of cricket. He loves to sit and enjoy a game of dominoes. He also loves football. His two favorite teams being Arsenal in the Premier League and Brazil in the World Cup. Benny also fancied himself as a singer, and I must say that he was fairly good at what? Fairly good at it, too. He had two favorite songs which he used to sing at karaoke. When You're in Love with a Beautiful Woman by Dr. Hook, and You Sexy Thing by Hot Chocolate. And if you saw Payne perform these two songs, you would know that, you know, many of you here may not be aware that in 1984, on the tour of England, Payne was the lead singer on a recording done to honor the West Indies cricket team and the then captain, Clive Lloyd, something of which Payne was very proud. In closing, let me say that if I had to choose a song that encapsulated Payne's life, it would have to be My Way by Frank Sinatra, because Thelston surely did it his way. Thelston Rodney Only Payne, a true Philippine and Barbados player. Farewell, my friend, until we meet again.
We now have a video presentation from the St. Catherine's Sports and Social Club.
So many things I can say about Thelston, because we go back over 50 years when we met at Princess Margaret Secondary School. Remember him coming in there as a very small guy with curly hair, jet black hair, and with some ears sticking out the side of his head like Joey Carew. And he was so small that everybody thought that, well, look, this guy can get let down if he gets somebody bowling a bouncer. But sooner or later, he proved them wrong. Thelston, even though the pads were all up by his waist, as Daniel recalled, when he bowling, the faster the bowling was, the more the better he would bat. He was quick on his feet, he had eyes like a hawk, and timing like a Swiss watch.
My name is Tony Wiltshire, and I've been president of St. Catherine's for the last 4 months. I must say that I envy those of us who knew Thelston intimately. I did not know him that well. Indeed, my first recollection was when we played a game in the round three on the 15 competition in the early 1970s, when Lodge played Princess Margaret. And the names which we feared from my school at Lodge were Carew and Wayne Daniel. And I'm happy to note that over the passing of time, that Carew and Wayne Daniel went on to play at the highest level. After the 1970s, of course, we went our separate ways. I kept abreast of Payne's development. The next time I had a conversation with him was 2 years ago, when briefly I told him that I needed to get a perspective from him on St. Catherine's development over the years, and he agreed. Unfortunately, that conversation never took place, and today we are faced with his passing.
my name is Romar Newton. I'm part of the St. Catherine Sports and Social Club. After the passing of Thelston Payne, the club hasn't been the same, feeling emotions and stuff. I just want to say that we miss you, coach, and we miss that you were always here for us and encouraging us to be the best that we can be. Some enjoyable moments I had with you, especially when we traveled to England in 2018. We had a game, and then we were in the bus going back to the hotel, and all of a sudden, I think we lost. Yeah, we lost that game, so we just came in the bus, and everybody was silent, and we just started singing. Everybody was singing with you, and it was a nice ride back home. And I can say that we miss you, coach.
I just want to start by saying Payne will be missed. If there's one thing I remember with Payne, it is that he was very supportive of us and the club. There was no game that was ever too far that you wouldn't hear Payne at the ground screaming for us to be better and do well. He was a very big fan of Occupation of the Crease. If there's one way he had an impact on me is that he was there at my very first game for my debut for the first team of the club. And I just remember him talking me through the innings from the sidelines and talking me through to keep it simple, stay still, stay at the crease, and keep batting on. And knowing that he had my back and knowing that he was supporting me from the sidelines, I always felt like if I could get the job done.
When I first heard the news that coach had passed, it rocked me to the core. And I'm sure it did everybody else that he would have interacted with. Payne was a major part of this club. You would struggle to find a sports person anywhere that when you hear the name, you immediately think of an institution. And that was Payne to St. Catherine's. For he was the institution. He was the heart, the soul of this club. Joining the club as a young man, Payne would have been like a cricket dad to us. We would come out as boys watching all of our heroes on TV, the Laras, the Vivertures, the Hoopers. But Payne was our hero. He was the man that we looked up to day in, day out. And he was not just our coach, he was the father figure. He was the person to guide us, whether it be cricket or life. Payne would be terribly missed by us, by myself, and I'm sure everybody else around here, because of his bubbly personality. It was always smiles, laughter, and fun when he's around. And I would like to extend my deepest sympathy to his family and his friends, and all of the cricketing fraternity in Barbados, and may he rest in peace.
Payne would always be ready to take up a challenge and was always willing to contribute to the team and the results thereof. I remember him as being generous and kind and very friendly. First thing we meet was a broad grin and a smile that you could never forget. The other thing about Thelston is that he could bat in any position. He used to walk quite well and he could bat in any position. He was really a right-hander who then turned and batted in left hand. A lot of people didn't know that. And he didn't start as a wicketkeeper either. He became a wicketkeeper after the regular wicketkeeper got hurt. And he took up the gloves and never looked back.
Coach Payne, Papi, as he was affectionately called by many. I had the privilege of working with Mr. Payne at the National Sports Council Summer Camp. And I was also fortunate enough to be coached by Coach Payne. He was more than just a coach. He was also a father figure. And what I can say is that he always treated me and everyone that I've seen him interacted with due respect. He was a fantastic human being. Payne, it's not been easy since you've left. All I know, I'm just trying to figure out who's going to shout from the benches or the amateur at Bayfield to tell me to not to flick at the leggy. But it's not, as you would say, things will never be the same, especially here at Bayfield. It's been tough, sir. But I hope for your sake that there's a karaoke in heaven. Hope you rest in peace and rise in glory. Till we meet again, Papi.
I've known Payne from the time I was 8 years old. He's been like a father to me, taking me from St. Martin's Margrove Primary onto Dayton Griffith, onto Polytechnic. And he's the main reason why he came to St. Catherine. I remember every Saturday, me and Payne used to go. I think he taught me a lot about life, taught me a lot about batting. He was a big, massive part of my success. He was like a dad to me. This really hurt me and hurt me real bad, but now I'm the coach, I plan to put everything into place that he taught me. Rest in peace, Penny. I will always love you, and I will never ever forget the things you did for me.
From all accounts, Thelston loved life, and he had unswerving commitment and dedication to St. Catherine's, which I find incredible to fathom. Thelston was, in every sense, a Philippine long before there was this outburst of persons claiming to be from St. Philip. Thelston was the first Filipino, I would say. And we remember this sudden outburst of joy and what we call feelings of being belonging to the parish after Placid Bay's victory in 1982. But before that, Thelston was the epitome of St. Philip. How do we honor a person like Thelston? It is difficult to say because I do not believe that physical structures and monuments can capture the contribution he has made in all spheres of life in St. Philip. Needless to say, I think that perhaps he has built for us, in a sense, a monument in our hearts, which I believe that the passage of time will never erase. To his family, at this point in time, I say keep the faith and be strong. Know that the rest of the St. Catherine's family are grieving with you. And at this point, I would wish to extend the deepest condolences to Damien and Dwayne, to Stephanie and others, to his immediate family and friends, on behalf of the St. Catherine's family. To Thelston, I say, I believe that you are watching and listening. Farewell. Thank you for everything.
Members of the St. Catherine Sports Club. We now invite the Director of the National Sports Council, Mr. Neil Morrow, to pay his tribute.
Good morning to all. Blessed morning to all. I recognize the Honorable Charles Griffith, Minister of Youth Sports and Community Empowerment, the Honorable Indar Weir, the Minister of Agriculture and Food Security and Member of Parliament for St. Philip's South, the area where Thelston comes from, I recognize Mr. Anthony Wilcher, the Permanent Secretary acting in the Ministry of Youth, Sport and Community Empowerment, Mr. Conde Riley, the President of the Barbados Cricket Association and members of the BCA. I also recognize the President of the Barbados Cricket Legends, and the cricket legends of Barbados, and also the chairman, the board and staff of the National Sports Council, past and present, the extended and the entire Payne family, representatives of schools and the media, and a special welcome to all, especially the Fulbay, St. Philip, and the St. Catherine family. Thelston Payne from Fulbay in St. Philip entered the National Sports Council on the 16th of April 1984. And while I was not there, I imagine he entered purposefully, just like when he was going out to bat for St. Catherine, with that Hilton leaning forward, quick walk, broad brim cricket hat, and ready wide smile, and saying to the then director, "I am reporting for duty, sir." While at the council, Thelston was assigned to work primarily at the St. Philip schools in the eastern part of Barbados. And when it came to doing the fixtures of the Herman Griffith cricket competition, he would also be in charge of the eastern zone, affording him the label, the mayor of St. Philip. As a coach, Thelston took his work very seriously, particularly at the Herman Griffith time. Every morning, he made personal contact with each of the game's teachers to ensure that there were no issues with pitch preparation or transportation. So meticulous was he. His enthusiasm for coaching with the Herman Griffith competition grew as he conducted sessions with schools that required extra attention after class had ended for the day. His other responsibilities included working with his fellow coaches to organize, as Milton Small said, a developmental squad of the Herman Griffith best players. Thelston excelled in this area, identifying many young players with the potential to take their game to the next level. Such was his effect on the schools in St. Philip that games teachers of the St. Mark's Primary, Mr. Winston Proverbs and Julian Griffith, penned a letter to the director of sport in 1991 indicating that the principal, staff and students acknowledge the contribution of coaches Anthony Jarvis, Milton Small, and Thelston Payne, but further noted that these coaches have also shown interest in the general welfare and development of the school, maintaining good rapport with staff and students. Indeed, a glowing and excellent report. Over a 10-year period, Thelston was a part of a consistent coaching staff that took the council's under 13 cricketers to St. Kitts and Nevis, Trinidad and Tobago, and the United Kingdom, working closely with coaches such as the late George Linton, Milton Small, Richard Struggle Straker, Ricky Skeet, and later DaCosta Arley. And that managed by Adrian Donovan, this team was simply unbeatable. In fact, the record shows that the team coached by Thelston, along with his teammates, played 45 games, winning 42, losing 2, and drawing 1. But the most memorable tour occurred in 2001 when Thelston toured the United Kingdom with 23 of these young cricketers. And he was not only a coach, but an ambassador of the highest order. Former school teacher Anthony Sargent organized the arrangement of Thelston to entertain at ceremonies. We would have heard his singing prowess a little earlier. He would entertain the audience by singing very popular and local songs, accompanied by the players and the musical band. The records show that this young team, coaching team, of which Thelston was a part, was critical in laying the groundwork for a number of young Barbadian and West Indian players. Thelston coached the current captain, Craig Baffert, as well as other Barbados, young, relatively young Barbados players, including Christopher Jordan, Carlos Brathwaite, Roston Chase, Shamar Brooks, Jonathan Carter, and Cal Mears, all of which you know, all of which some of them currently play. He was in charge of young and upcoming wicketkeepers like Collis Worrell, Shea Hope, Ronaldo Holder, and Shane Durich. Indeed, Thelston was not about remaining static as a coach and was always about learning and improving in his cricket coaching staff. His file records indicate that he went to do advanced coaching courses organized by the West Indies Cricket Board and also various coaching development courses organized by the England and Wales Cricket Board. He was also a national cricket selector. Thelston meant a lot to the staff, both past and present, of the National Sports Council, who worked across many sectors. Anthony Leacock, the supervisor, said that Thelston was a go-getter. He loved the sport and cricket and worked well with all the schools. The children loved him. He was a good man. Harry Blades, the retired clerical officer, indicated that Payne was a good work colleague, a good man, and importantly, a good limer at the telephone cricket bar. He was at every NSC tour. Carolyn Vaughan, fellow coach, noted that Thelston was a dedicated and enthusiastic worker, very encouraging to staff, especially those who were coming in. She indicated that he don't think he ever missed a session and gave 150%. Was a good person, and she emphasized, had a phenomenal, and she said that to me, Mr. Murley, I want you to indicate that. He had a phenomenal personality and was the life of the party. The staff really, the NSC staff really loved Thelston right up to his retirement in 2017 after 33 years. And even up to the end, veteran coaches Milton Small and Sandrine Best Jordan especially were among those who were there up to his final days. Perhaps though, two things I found while preparing for this speech emphasize his overall character and the type of person and coach that he was. A 1999 25th anniversary special book outlining the history of winners of the Barbados Fire and Commercial Insurance Cup champions. On the 12th of November 1978, when St. Catharines lifted their first championship playing against Banks, the man of the match was, you guessed it, the 21-year-old Thelston Payne. St. Catherine lost by 4 runs in the 1989 finals, but Captain Payne notably did not contribute significantly with the bat. They, however, won again in 1992. Payne not only played a solid role against police, but it was his young protege, Gregory Jones, who did the damage with the bat. And when they defeated police in the 1996 final, surely they made it blue, Cablin Royalist BT away with 6 for 18, but it was the 39-year-old Payne who anchored the small chase of 127 with 68 not out, over 50% of the score, taking control and steadying, perhaps the wobbling, St. Catherine at that time to win by 5 wickets. Significantly also, with the unveiling of the name of his pavilion at his alma mater, Princess Margaret, in 2005, he dressed sharply in his National Sports Council's blazer, signifying to the young students, especially, his current working position. These small events showcase and emphasize what Thelston was all about. He was about commitment, longevity, a genius coach and cricketer, a humble servant, and importantly, a proud loyalty to club, country, and the National Sports Council. The National Sports Council is dressed in shirts with its favorite color, green, as a show of gratitude. We love and we'll always remember you, Papi. We will always remember you, Carew. We always remember you, the Mayor of St. Philip. We thank you, Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne, for your coaching role model and for the memories. We thank you.
Thank you. We now have a tribute in song by Miss Tanya Clark, Wind Beneath My Wings.
Good morning. Content to let me shine, 'cause that's your way. You always walked a step behind. So I was the one with all the glory, while you were the one with all the strength. Beautiful face without a name for so long, dear. Beautiful smile to hide the pain. Did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to. You are the wind beneath my wings. It might have appeared to go unnoticed, but I've got it all here in my heart. I want you to know I know the truth, of course I know of it, that I would be nothing without you. Oh, did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to be. And I can fly higher than an eagle, 'cause you are the wind beneath my wings. Did I ever tell you you're my hero? You're everything I wish I could be. Can fly higher than an eagle, 'cause you are the wind beneath my wings. 'Cause you are the wind beneath my wings. our wings. Oh, you are the winds beneath our wings. We know you touch the sky. Thank God for you, the wind beneath our wings.
Thank you, Tammy. We now have our final tribute from the chairman of the National Sports Council and former president and coach of St. Catherine's Social and Sports Club, Mr. Matt Donald Fingal.
Morning. Could we all stand up just for a second, please? Everybody just stand. When I look at the program here, it's clear that we're going to be sitting for a long time, and it is not healthy to sit down for too long. I'm very serious. It actually adds to the promotion of prostate cancer if you sit for too long. You can check it out for yourself. You will notice in the Anglican church, after a song, you got to stand up, sit down, and keep it moving. But we're here because you got a eulogy to come, and I'm going to try to be sharp myself, but you need to get the blood flowing, so please, could you sit down now? Please, you can sit. I hope you understand what I'm really trying to do here. Good morning again. We're here to celebrate the life of Thelston Payne. Celebrate. I find it difficult right now to celebrate, but we have to. Because that's the new thing we have. Years ago, we used to just grieve and mourn and cry a lot. Yes, you got to mourn, you got to grieve, but you got to celebrate. Some years ago, I was given a letter to take to Princess Margaret School, and the letter said that this gentleman is coming to be your PE teacher at the school. I went there, gave the letter to the headmaster. He read it, looked at me and talked to me for a little bit, and asked me if I could help out with English. I told him, sir, he thinks that physical education. He talked some more, and then he asked me if I could help out with maths. I said, sir, he thinks that physical education. He talked some more, he mentioned geography. I said, sir, give me my paper, let me head back where you come from. But then he changed his mind and he said, okay. Then I got to realize that they did not have a PE program. The teachers that you handled anything to do PE were actually teaching other things. I was then the only person that come to teach PE. Somebody was doing maths to help with PE, somebody doing English to help PE. So then when I checked the schedule, I would only be working really one day a week for about a couple hours. So we had to make some adjustments. So when we made adjustments, we took people out of different classes and brought them to PE. And then one day, the math teacher who was helping me PE called Tim Weeks. After we had the program running, he called me to a side and he said, see that little half-looking Indian boy there? When you chasing out people out the bathroom to bring next class, leave he. And he played with the next class. He going to be a cricketer. After, I think Tyson must have been first form or something. I should not be telling you this because then you're going to work out that I'm older than Tyson. However, it started then for me with my relationship with this little man. But I left him. I didn't stay that long. It was a primary for enough to make an impact, but it went on. When I came back home now to teach at law school, again, this man showed up as a coach. But what I recognized about him, he would not coach like the rest. Some of the rest would come and do the hour and leave. He would come there about 3 o'clock, and he would not leave till about 5:30, something 6 o'clock when the bus comes. He would coach and coach and coach. Maybe it was because his last class for that day. However, he was that committed. Then I move on to being a coach at St. Catherine's Club. And again, Thelston Payne. I am telling you now, what struck me about Thelston Payne is his ability to follow instructions. I have coached basketball, football, cricket, track and field, even golf. We all can coach it. But I never met anybody that can follow instructions to the bone like Thelston Payne. I'll give you a couple of examples quickly. We were playing against, I believe it was Carlton, because the fellow Matthews was in the, remember, Haley Matthews' father was in the team. And I had instructed, we were fit. St. Catherine's thing, they're fit, ready to run all day. So I told Thelston, we're going to run them to the ground to 4:30. And only two of we can get tired. All of them get tired running the field. All I want the boundaries, ones and twos till 4:30. And after 4:30, we can beat ball. And at that point, the twos are going to become fours and the ones become threes and all kind of stuff will happen here because they're going to wear it down to nothing. Somewhere around 4:15 or so, Matthews probably got drift of what we were doing and he came on and bowled a lollipop, tossed it up. And Thelston patted it there for one and then sent and called me and asked me, what's the time? I said, 4:15. He said, Lord have mercy. I can't wait the 4:30. That ball should go on a gallon backyard. Which is true. And I believe that other men in the team would have disobeyed and hit him backyard and then they got quarreling for hitting the six. But that's how he was. Then we met the Maple to play cricket. And I had to leave the game early to go on the MC show. I think MC Hammer was performing, so we had to go on MC show. So I had to give him instructions before he left. And I worked out the schedule. I went to Thelston. I said, listen, you got to make 10 runs over for 7 overs, and after that, 7 runs over. When I was walking away, he called me back. Give me again. I said, 10 runs over for 7 overs, and after that, 7 runs over, and we would get home. He said, 10 and 7 and 7? Yeah. And I left. Later on at the show, I saw Roy Stewart, who was the cameraman, coming to film the show. I said, what happened to cricket? He said, Thelston made 10 runs over for 7 overs, and then make 7 runs over. I said, so we get home? He said, we get home, but I had a problem. When you hear what happened now, the umpire, we had, you know, he's got about 15 overs in the last hour. Up to the last over to bowl, one over to bowl, we only need 6 runs now. And the umpire called off the game. And apparently what happened to the morning Maple man was accused of going and stand up on the balls when he boundary so he could find it. And we had a little discussion about it, but eventually they just scrapped the game, that kind of way. But he only wanted 6 more runs in the last over. He played it to the bone. That's the type of person he was, the best follower of instructors I have ever met, Thelston Payne. Now, he only disappointed me once. And would you believe that he wrote a letter of apology? Very serious, that's how he was. I became president of the club after that. And then I was still coaching the team. But suddenly BCA decided to go pay coaches. And I called Thelston and said, Thelston, listen, I can't take this money. Because I can't guarantee to get here. If I take this money as a coach, I got to be here on time every day. I can't guarantee to get here on time. I got other things going on. So I will let you to coach the team. But at that time, he was also a selector for the Barbados team. And he started to ask me about it. He seemed to think it was a conflict to be selected Barbados team and coaching the team where he got to pick people from for the Barbados team. He told me he didn't want to think about it. Came back and he told me he wanted to coach the team, so he resigned from being a selector. That is integrity. Because I know people that will do all too. That's the pain, such as a conflict. And that's the type of person he was, a man of integrity. In 2008, I was not only president, I was also chairman of the selector committee. And because of the portion of practice, I fired 8 men. Only 3 men from the team before were playing. I even played a man that never played cricket before. And the people wanted to kill my finger. So we showed the player Empire Cricket Club. I'm trying to show you now the genius in Thelston Payne. Not only a good form of instruction, not only a man of integrity, but a genius batsman. He might not be a genius cricketer, but he's a genius batsman. He understands the game. So when we played Empire in the first match, all of a sudden, we is 30 for 3. And St. Catherine's supporter left out there by the pavilion and walked in front of me and looked at me in a kind of way that they could tell me what I wanted, but they say. And they went back. And then suddenly it was 60 for 5. And they get up again and walk in front of me. I mean, more cruel. Batson was batting. He might have was just reading the thing just now. And suddenly saw Batson call me and tell me, he was there when it was 60 for 5. He called me and tell me, Mr. Finger, I got a problem playing a left-hand bowler from thing, I don't know if you all remember his name, Perryman. He said, I got a problem playing Perryman, can't get him playing. So he sent for Payne. He said, Payne, come quick, talk to Batson, he got a problem with Perryman. Payne spent 3 seconds with Batson, 3 seconds. And suddenly saw Batson went back and started beating ball. And suddenly saw me 225 for the same 5. And not a boy from this thing, Catherine Payne coming from me, look at me, tell me nothing. That's some Payne. A batting genius. He understood the game. He understood this complex game. This cricket game is a complex game. It is an individual sport. It's a dual sport. Dual D-U-E-L and D-U-A-L. And it's also a team sport. And he understood it that way. Because it's an individual sport when it's a trial match. Because in the trial match, you got to play for yourself. You got to get any team. You got to play to win the game. You got to play for yourself. He would do that in the trial match. And it's a duel when two people do A-L. Do you well when two people batting together because the partnerships are key to the game? He can master that too. And then there's a duel between batsman and bowler, and he would master that too. And then this game that is so beautiful is also a team game, and he could play that too. This man here mastered his craft, that was his gift. But because of that genius, he could not understand that you don't understand. That's the problem with geniuses. I remember Wes Hall told me he was batting with Gary Sobers one time. And he played and missed. And Sobers asked him, what happened there? And he said, ball turning. And Sobers Hall saw. And Wes said to me, Matt, they don't understand that you don't understand. So the only time I said, by most times, Thelston would get upset is when he keep telling me, man, I tell him, man, so. I said, but Thelston, they don't understand. He said, I don't understand. I said, but Thelston, they can't understand. But he said, it's simple. I said, it's simple to you. That's how geniuses are. So then we had a deal. I struck a deal where I said, listen, you do the coaching, I'm going to be talking. So I would do all the talking from then on. And we worked like that right through. Earlier, you heard a call you Pappy. When I first heard that, I was upset. I interpreted that as disrespect. I had a vex and I was quarreling about it. We called him my pappy. But later on, I get to find out it wasn't disrespect. It was love. It was endearment. It was a term of endearment. It was respect, in essence. That's how comfortable I felt with him. The next thing, the last thing I want to explain to you about this brother is his commitment to St. Catherine's. In sports, where the members of the team are constant, they're there for a long time. You will notice it, especially in American football and sometimes basketball. After about 4 years, the coach tends to lose the energy and don't have that, get that kind of result you would want. And the coach will either resign or he's fired and they'll bring a new coach. Doesn't mean that the coach is a bad coach. It's just that that happens. So when that happens and you bring a new coach with new energy, then the team is going again. It doesn't work really that way with school teams. Like when I was at large, I could stay forever because the team would change. The members would leave. They leave school. But when you got the members over and over after 4 or 5 years. So I discussed that with Thelston Payne. I told Thelston Payne that we would do better if you were to leave and go and coach another team and let somebody, a new coach come in. Thelston told me he understand. But he looked at me in a way, straight in my ear and hollered, Mr. Finger, I ain't leaving St. Catherine. And he was prepared to accept a coach coming there, but he ain't going to coach nowhere else. He was committed to St. Catharines. He loved St. Catharines. Like, no, but I don't know how you could love St. Catharines better or love anything better. As the man said before, he carried apart there when he just come apart and sit down. At every game, we got a young team called Barracudas on the 13. He's there supporting. Sometimes he's sick and he still come. That's who we're talking about. They call him the Mayor of St. Philip. He was our hero. And you called St. Philip, you texted Philip, you said, oh, we clannish? Yes, we clannish, but it didn't just that we arranged or decided to be clannish. It was because of how we were marginalized, how we were treated. Because when they would come up from town, they would look at us and see walking with, call us barefoot chicken and country buck and laugh at we. And we used to feel bad, we couldn't say we couldn't do nothing. But all of a sudden we had a champion, we had Thelston Payne, who we could stand up for we. And sure that we had somebody that couldn't say nothing about, so we the proud. And then came along with plastic bag and make it worse. Thelston Payne is our champion. I remember Karl Marx, the man that, a German fellow that coined the Communist Manifesto, he said the proletariat breeds the revolution. So when you got the proletariat, you got that person downtrodden, they tend to revolt. But we didn't organize a revolt, we just bonded. So when Thelston came, and I went to watch him at cricket, at Kensington, every stroke he made was a stroke of excitement and expectation. And people love it. They went just to see Thelston. And I want to quote before I leave from Horace, the Italian poet, who said, "We shall build a monument more lasting than bronze, which the wasting rains nor time will destroy. Our records might not be written on stone, but in the hearts of men." This man's record might not be written in stone, but it's definitely written in the hearts of men. Not only from St. Philip, not only from Barbados, but of all people who he came across. Thelston Payne is our Philippian hero. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fingal. I now invite Albert Proverbs and Stephen Lord to do the eulogy.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Morning. Forgive me. Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne, he was born the 13th of February 1957 in Faubourg St. Philip, the son of Joseph and Beryl Payne, father of Damien Payne, Dwayne Atkinson, grandfather of Zion Payne, and beloved brother of Jacqueline Valerie Addington, Barry Payne, Stephanie King, and the late Agnell Hinkson. Friend of Pauline Atkinson, and friend of too many to mention at this time. He was affectionately known as Penny, Pappy, Carew, and Trot. The well-known umpire Patrick Gazette and myself thought he was trustworthy, reliable, outspoken, and persistent. Precious memories by Stephanie King and family. His sunny smile, the hearty laugh, the generous hugs, beloved dad, brother, uncle, a true son of the soil, faithful to community and country, the moniker Carew, was given to him in the early cricket days. It was said that he looked like the famous cricketer from Trinidad, Michael Joy Carew. He even batted left hand like him and had straight curly hair. The difference was that Thelston was actually right-handed but preferred to bat left-handed.
Thelston's early education and interest in cricket started at the St. Martin's Primary and continued at the Victoria Sports Club, which was a mere 100 yards away from his home. It was there that he witnessed the cricket clashes between teams participating in the Barbados Cricket League competition, Some of these teams were Victoria, Rangers, Crane, and St. Catharines. It was also there that under the watchful eye of Charles Deacon Laurier, a relative, and Louis Greenidge, Horace Franklin, a mentor, and Lloyd Walcott, that his love and passion for the game developed. He will move on to Princess Margaret Secondary School, where he got his first taste of competitive cricket, competing in the annual Ronald Tree competition. It was here that he developed a lasting friendship with his fellow teammates, Claymont Jordan, Wayne Zephyr Daniel, Albert Proger Proverbs, Denton Piercer Hoyt. He was a lover of sport and participated in hockey, table tennis, and football. But his love was not limited to these outdoor activities, for he loved to dance. He loved rhythm poetry and singing. And I recall on our many trips on the team bus where he often led us in song. Thelston Payne was an exceptional human being who God bless with a cricketing talent. He was quiet and well-mannered, always immaculately dressed. He was comfortable in the classroom and was a good writer. He was popular at school. With his long, curly black hair, he was a favorite with the girls. However, it was on the cricket pasture that we saw his prowess. Wayne Daniel once said of him, "I didn't think he was much bigger than the bat, and sometimes the pads would dwarf him. He just stood above the stumps. What he lacked in height, biceps, and shoulders, he made up with a big heart and fearless attitude, particularly against fast bowlers. From his early days, he had good technique against the quick, hooking, pulling, cutting, glancing. These were some of the strokes that he would play against the bowlers if they were fractionally short.
I fondly remember this one cricket match against psychiatric hospital, where we were advised not to sledge our opponents. This one strapping fast bowler by the name of Holder from the other side said, "Let us blow away these tiny boys and go home and watch some movies." And with that, the first ball was dispatched into the market. While they were looking, searching for that ball, Payne walked down the pitch, like Gary Sobers, walked down the pitch with a crouch and tapped the wicket like Sir Gary Sobers. The angry bowler pitched short again, and he was dispatched forward square onto the workshop where his pavilion bear his name right now. Someone in the crowd shouted, "Penny can't drive." The bowler unwittingly pitched the ball up into the slot, where he was met with a glorious drive onto the roof of the classroom. The teacher came out and investigated the loud thump. And after he saw Penny batting at the crease, he dismissed the class and allowed the students to watch the remainder of the innings. Subsequent to early outstanding performance in school, he was invited to youth trials and selected to join the 1974 Barbados under 19 team to Ghana. I recall support coming from Princess Margaret cricket team coming especially from the Six Roads and Marksfield community. We always remember people like the former Attorney General Adriel Braffitt, Andrew Cocky Carter, and the Clark brothers. Great support was also given by the teachers, Rudolph Cappy Grinnies, Hal Gollop, Reverend Bernard Griffith, and Alvin Carter, who also played with us. Mr. Simon Jones, Timothy Weeks, Winston Proverbs, the fitness trainer Matt Fingal, and Seymour Nurse, the coach, was always there for us. Princess Margaret was the most feared cricket team in the late 60s, early 70s. Danny was bowling fast like a zephyr. Payne was batting beautifully like Joey Carew. Lord was solid like Joe Solomon. Yours truly caressed a few through the covers every now and then. We cannot forget other members of the team, players like Claremont, Saltbred, Jordan, the pro Tony King, Rex Mosley, Colin Chase, Denton Pearson Hoyt, Patrick's, Paddy Seeley, Paddy Duke Seeley, Colin Gooden, and the brothers Harold Blackman, he's Harold Stocky Blackman, and Winston Chase.
After the passing of his mother, he loved cooking and he wanted to show his independence. After the passing of his mother, Payne, who loved cooking, he wanted to show his independence. So he would often cook for himself, but his specialty was the 1-2-3. He was employed for a short while at Sam Law's castle, and there he met the late Ada Allen, the mother of one of his friends, Victor Percy Braffitt. She was a good cook, and she gave him some tips on how to improve his culinary skills. We then saw where he moved from cooking the 1-2-3 to a full course meal, and he was very proud to share with anyone who visited his home, especially his two friends, Don Parris and Peter Rowe.
Payne, along with his friends, ventured to St. Catherine Sports Club with a goal to help the team make it into Division I cricket. It was there his loyalty, commitment, and determination were evident, eventually achieving that set goal. One of Payne's most treasured moments was winning the Division I Cup in 1981, and then the next day we went on to Kensington Oval and won the French General Insurance Cup. He went on to play for Barbados and the West Indies, where his performances were well documented. Outside being an outstanding player, he was inspirational in the growth of many young cricketers on the island. Many went on to play for Barbados and West Indies. He was also instrumental in helping Bailey School and St. Catherine's Club to win many titles.
On the behalf of his sons, Damien and Dwayne, siblings Jackie, Valerie, Addington, Stephanie and Barry, and the entire Payne family, I extend their thanks to the Foul Bay and the world community and the wider St. Philip community, the St. Catherine Sports and Social Club, the Barbados Cricket Association, the cricket legends of Barbados, you wonderful people here today, and those attending the live stream, for all the love, care, and support shown. You have been truly amazing with your pouring of love, respect, and heartfelt tributes. He may have reached the end of his journey with us here on earth, and now is among the stars in the night sky. But he will never be forgotten. As the lyrics to the song goes, we will always keep him close. Let not our hearts be sorrowful, for he is gone to a better place.
Thank you.
As we begin the formal part of the service, we invite you to stand.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant, Thelston Rodney O'Neill, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, he may share in the eternal. Who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We join our voices together. Invite the men and the men only to sing the second verse. We sing the third verse together. And the ladies alone on the fourth verse, and we will all join in on the final verse. Angel voices ever singing. Men in the congregation here now. Thank you. kindly be seated for the ministry of the word. We invite Miss Cheryl Greenidge to read our first lesson, and that will be followed by the second, Mr. Joel Garner.
The reading is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning at the 6th verse. For I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now, there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Reading from the Gospel of Jesus Christ, taken from John chapter 14, beginning at the first verse. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, ye may be also. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. This is the word of the Lord.
We now sing our next hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Unfortunately, I cannot lead the singing because I can't sing, but I'm sure that all you good cricketers know how to sing. So let's stand and lustily sing, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
I speak to you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Kindly be seated. Let me first acknowledge the presence of the Honorable Charles Griffith, Minister of Sports, Youth, and Community Empowerment, and the Honorable Indar Weir, Minister of Agriculture and Food Security, along with other members of Parliament, and Mr. Anthony Wilcher, President of the St. Catherine Sport and Social Club, and of course all of you who have come to join with this family as they say goodbye. Right, I was just making sure that it was still morning. This morning, we have gathered as family and friends in this Garfield Sober Sports Complex to give God thanks and say goodbye to Thelston Rodney O'Neill Payne, known to his friends as Carew, a man by all means and purpose who is quite at home right now as he rests for a few moments in this building which bears the name of one who excelled in the game which the deceased loved so much. A game in which he used his gifts and skills for honoring his country, the Caribbean, his community, and the many youngsters who passed through his nourishment in the sports arena via the National Sports Council, where he worked. These special moments in this service offer for those of you present here in person, and the many more following on live stream, the opportunity to use the 3 hours as we join together to support this family and the cricketing fraternity, not only for this moment, but even when this day is past. The opportunity, Christian friends, it's yours to remember, review, and refocus. Dr. George Sheehan, in his book, Running and Being, wrote, and I quote, "I am at my best nearing the finish of a race. Until then, I am just another mediocre distant runner. Just one of the many run-of-the-mill competitors, well back in the pack. Just one more old man trying to string together 6 minutes, miles, and not quite succeeding. But with the finish line in sight, all that changes. Now I am equal of anyone. I am world class. I am unbeatable. Gray-haired and balding and starting to wrinkle, but world class. Gasping and wheezing and groaning, but unbeatable." An accomplished cardiologist, author, and marathon runner, George Sheehan, lived his life with passion and purpose. Even when confronted with the terminal illness, he demonstrated courage and determination. He ran life's race, and he finished strong. Today, I believe from all that I've heard, that Thelston Carew Payne, even with his own health challenges, was determined to finish his race strong. As with Dr. Sheehan, Thelston and all the others who have gone before us, they too determined to end their race strong. We are reminded this morning that the day will come for each one of you, along with myself, to finish life race also. In 2 Timothy 4, we read how the time had come for Paul to end his race. In a few than 100 words, he shared with us the hardship of his present, the heartbeat of his past, and the hope he holds for the future. In this brief passage, Paul reflects on his life and ministry. He looked around and looked back, and then he looked ahead with the finish line in sight. As he picks up the pace, Paul sums up his dynamic life and his hope in death. The lessons we learn from this aging apostle will enable us, will enable you to run well today while encouraging you to finish strong tomorrow. Like Paul, who was able to look back and share, you too remember as we share in the tributes. And I'm sure that every time you heard his name mentioned, each of you recalls something about Thelston. Times on the cricket field, the nail-biting moment of a crucial match. Now, I did not, and I want you to know that that man, Milton, was checking my notes, not me checking his. The date is the test cricket, the test match against England at Queen's Park Oval. And the quotation says that the stylish left-hand batsman and well-reliable wicket-keeper Payne is on the team. He is featured in a team that includes West Indies great Viv Richards, Gordon Greenidge, my good friend Desmond Haynes, Richie Richardson, the man called Joe Gano, who just had to make me look sharp, who I remember as a young girl in school going to Kensington, and we are sitting in the school stand and we are right behind Mr. Garner. And we're saying it soft because we have to respect the elders. Big Bergen, do he know, boy. Malcolm Marshall and Courtney Walsh. Payne took 5 catches in that match and they won. Yes, you will remember. Reliable sources tell me. Yes, you will remember the laughter and its colorful language when the present West Indies team was doing, according to him, foolishness. Damien remembered never being lashed by his dad. I hope that's true, Damien. I'm quoting Damien. But what he does remember, that whenever he came home from a cricket match, his dad asking him, how you do, Damien? How you doing the game? Not good, Daddy. What happened? I got bowled out. Boy, you mean you can't even defend your stumps? What you take the bat there for? Use it. Well, worse, when you tell Daddy that you got caught. Boy, I tell you, stop hitting the ball in the air. Hit it on the ground. They can't catch you so easy if you keep it on the ground. You will remember, good friends, that Thelston would give advice even if he was asked or not. A memory is told that if he is traveling or if he is watching or he found a game that interests him, he will stop to watch. And if the men on the team were playing anything else except cricket, his voice could be heard shouting across the field,
Yo, do that. No, not that. We remember the man. Such are the memories and many more which are called to mind today. But Christian friends, for those of us left behind, we are called to remember today too the frailty of our own life, the frailty of life. Paul's words are dictated shortly before his marathon at the decree of Roman Emperor Nero. He recalls his 30 years of travel, witness, and worship, preaching throughout the Mediterranean world. It was not a smooth journey. He had been helped and hated, assist and attacked, blessed and cursed. Whatever else can be said of his faith and life, it was certainly wasn't a dull one. And now, enjoying imprisonment and anticipating his execution, Paul shares with young Timothy not to be puffed up, but rather he helped him to heighten his awareness of what he was going to face in his own ministry and the importance of how he should carry it out. Funeral services such as this calls us to stop and look back and to check where we are focusing. Where are we focusing our time and talent? It calls us to stop and to look at the importance of our time and season and how we are using it. All of you who are present here, the question is being asked of you, what legacy are you leaving behind so at the end of your journey, others can speak to? So we are not only called to remember then, we are called to review our life. Paul himself, as you heard, said, I am a drink offering about to be poured out. What is the apostle saying? In ancient Rome, banquets commonly ended with a particular ritual, the symbolic act of pouring out on the ground a cup of wine in honor of the Roman gods. Paul borrows this image and he says that his life is an offering poured out for the Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, this fits with Paul's belief that all of life is to come under the lordship of Christ. All of life is to be regarded as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, as written in Romans 12. In effect, the apostle is saying, the Roman authorities will not take my life. Rather, I will die living my life, giving my life for the Lord. I have been a living sacrifice, serving him since the day I met him, says Paul. Now I will complete that sacrifice by laying down my life for the one who gave it to me. As we review our own life, what or who are you pouring out your life to? Our brother, though not perfect, sought to, in his retirement, not to sit down and rust out, but rather to give himself as a mentor, to help where he was needed. As you review your life today, what are you doing? Are you being poured out for others? What gifts and skills can you use to help the youth of our time? I remember playing cricket with a piece of coconut branch, you know, the end. I had brothers. I would get out by the first ball. But at least I had children time. Many of our young people don't have children time because those who are ahead of them don't mentor them. Some of us lead them astray. What are you doing with your gifts and skills to help the youth in our time? What is important to you? Or what are you doing if you're neglecting your family because today you heard that he loved his sons? How are you mentoring your children? How do you represent your country in the sporting fraternity? Do you remember your humble beginnings and the ones who would have given you the many nudges so that you can be where you are today? When your time comes to end this earthly journey, would you have left a legacy that you can be proud of and others can use it as a template for their own lives? Therefore, this service not only invites you to review, but it invites you to take the final R. It invites you, yes, to review your earthly portfolio, but it also asks you to review your spiritual portfolio. You know, many people are caught up with reviewing earthly things at the expense of their souls. How is your relationship with your God? Does he play a role in your life? I am told that the brother would find some time to worship at the St. Martin's Church. Do you find time to worship? The Psalms reminds us in Psalms 90 that all day, all life will come to an end on earth, and it is important to number our days so that our spiritual portfolio would be intact. As you review, and we now come to the refocusing part, I'm sure that on the opportunities at the crease, when things look grim, our brother refocus. He changed his focus, not concentrating on the negative or the people who might be sending the negative things from the stands, but he looked for ways to bring a positive outcome. Using his favorite phrase, he pushed on through the smoke. According to him, I going through, I am no quitter. What about you? In 2 Timothy 4, 6, the apostle looked around at his present hardship. And then in 2 Timothy 3, 7, Paul looks back on his life and he remembers the heartbeat of his past. For over 30 years, he was faithfully serving his God. In this verse, we find the images that I would like you to take with you as we come to an end. Paul likened his life and ministry to that of a long-distance runner who competed honorably in the Asian Olympic Games. He said, I have fought the good fight. And the word fight is not like how people use fight today in violence. But the text refers to any athletic contest in the game. This means carrying, or it carries a much broader meaning than we commonly associate with fight. The word agon, from which we derive our English word agony. It pictures an athlete coming off the field, having given of his best and his best. Here Paul is truthfully saying that he has given his best for Christ. I believe the brother gave his best. He says, I have run the race. Having given his best, like Paul now sees himself as crossing the finish line. It is easy to begin a race. It is easy to run hard for a few miles, but it is much harder to finish a long-distance race, and harder still to finish strong. I believe, just as Paul is telling Timothy, he says to each of us, that water the Christian life is not sprint competition, Rather, it's a long-distance race, a marathon-type challenge, beckoning us to run well, to keep the pace and to stay focused and to finish strong. It says, like the brother, that even though things may not always be right, things may not always go your way, I am still going to persevere and finish strong. As you say goodbye, I invite you to refocus, to use your gifts and skills, like Thelston, to give life, to give your life your all in spite of the challenges, to look at your priorities, and if they are out of sync, get back on target. To understand, Christian friends, that because of the frailty of life, it is important to make sure that your relationship with your God is intact, and that, as he said, you love one another and uplift each other. The apostle concludes his book, his look back on his life, by stating, "I have kept the faith." If we understand this statement in the context of the ancient Olympic Games, Paul is telling us that he has run the race according to the rules. And I heard my member from my congregation at St. Mark's, Max, saying that Thelston understood the rules to the end. We too are called to live by the rules. History reveals that the early Greeks and Roman athletes took a solemn oath before the games. They pledged that they would compete honestly and honorably. Here's Paul at the end of his race, affirming that his vows have been kept. And to whom were these vows made? To his Lord. This morning, are you living honestly and honorably? Can others say that you live your life and play your games by the rules? This is Paul's hope and joy as his life nears its end. He looks ahead with confidence and certainty. He shares his joy with Timothy, reminding this young man that a crown awaits not only him, but anyone who trusts and serves God to the end. Consider your own life. Do you have that same kind of hope and assurance? You may feel pressed and present on every side, but there's hope. Thelston was not perfect, but by no means. But he knew there must be a place in our life for our Creator. And in his own way, he acknowledged that. He took the talents God gave him, and in his season, used them for country and others. His love for others today is played out as he gives his final earthly gift to you. The opportunity today to stop and heed the advice, to remember that life is fragile, to review where your priorities are, and to refocus on this, your earthly race. As you and I run the race and set the pace before us today and tomorrow, take time to reflect, good friends, on how you're running. Remember Paul's words for Timothy. Realize that with the Lord, you too can fight the fight and run the race and keep the faith. With the Lord, you can run well and finish strong. I believe the brother embraced that. And this afternoon, family, take comfort in knowing that your brother, your dad, your uncle, your cousin gave of his best. And you too now are called to carry on the legacy. May you be comforted by the soothing grace of our Heavenly Father and the love of all of us who mourn with you the death of our beloved Thelston. May God bless you today as we say goodbye. Amen. I invite you now to stand, and on page 8 in your order of service, to share in the faith that we believe in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the dead, and life everlasting. Amen. Our intercessory prayers.
At the end of each petition, your response is, hear our prayer. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead, for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, may we be strengthened in our faith, live the rest of our lives in the fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, show mercy to the dying. Strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, we commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we share with them in your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Father of all, we pray for this, our brother Thelston, and for all those who we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. May he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. We have now the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saint, with sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, form of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave, we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth.
Let us commend our brother Thelston to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Thelston, O Sovereign Lord, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitation, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God forever and ever. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Thelston. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints. Amen. Our closing hymn, the hymn, And Can It Be?
Thank you.
taken away the sin of the world, Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name. Say, come, my Lord, bless you and my Father. In heaven, the kingdom to bear for you. In the world, Christ will be able to see you. Thank you.
Ready? Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead would also give new life to all mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life in your presence. There is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and then stays and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In our mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you.
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Thelston Ronald O'Neill. And we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love, and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this, our brother, Thelston, and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirit of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the soul of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good example of all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen. Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection receive the blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you and from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Christ our Mediator and Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, O Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord.
And let thy perpetual shine upon him.
May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen.
The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. Unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Our first hymn we sing, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
This is my story.
it is well with my soul. Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, that this your servant who has gone before us with the sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to him and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit rest and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. We stand now for the final farewell.
flower on the shelf, standing by herself. Never had the nerve to take a chance, so let the little girl dance.
Let the little girl dance. Let the little girl dance. She never danced before, so let her on the floor. Let the little girl dance. Let the little girl dance. She wants to give it a try, so let the little girl buy. She's been a little wallflower on the shelf, standing by herself. Now she got the nerve to take the chance, so let the little girl dance. Let the little girl through.
Was the favorite song of the brother. And now go in peace, and the God of peace go with you.
Everybody tells her.